Well, this poem, which comes right out of writing the book, the memoir on my dyslexia, is really the first poem I've written that deals with the subject, which is, I guess, interesting. It's forthcoming in Plowshares, I think, in November. Hitting and getting hit. It's the experience of being bullied. They could say what they liked, imitate the way I stuttered the morning pledge, mashed the alphabet, ask how many chickens 1 plus 3 made, why my brain sat in a corner in a class of 1, refused to read or write, was nailed to my tongue, just as long as they understood that some with my fist would be kissed, yanked off their bikes by their hair, their eyeballs thumb scrubbed, faces autographed by sidewalks, that under no circumstance would they ever make me cry. In newsreels, Dad and I watched withered souls in striped pajamas stare from behind electrified wire, as if not seeing or asking why would save them. Jews like us, Dad said. The next day he threw a man twice his size down factory stairs because he didn't say good morning back. I understood then that dignity wasn't an entitlement. Goodness didn't mean being good. Justice wouldn't be my inheritance. Even after the Hildebrand twins hung me upside down from death, Mrs. Palofsky's cherry tree pushed me off the garage roof through crazy Mr. Selby's porched window, who then chased us with a pitchfork, a red sea squirting from my thumb, Mom screaming at God for hating us, Benny the junkman driving me to the ER in a souped-up Dodge pickup where the doc asked, isn't this the third time I've stitched you up? I wouldn't. Not even when a wop and two Polacks wrote kike and black lipstick on my forehead, kicked me in the stomach 5 times, because in our neighborhood Jews pay to go to school, and I sat drinking Cokes and spitting blood in our uncut backyard grass, and then went looking for them, and cops picked me up and drove me around, explaining the way things worked. Know who to be afraid of, son. Not even after I didn't go to school and snuck into the Paramount to sit in the filthy dark grid of the balcony, stinking of popcorn and savoring every eschatological thought the rowdy cowboys and impenitent gangsters mumbled about how freedom, privacy, and mercy were expendable if you owned enough land, oil, cattle, and violence, enough pilgrim faith and belonging somewhere. Not even up there under the painted stars with only an illiterate God for company, surrounded by the ear-popping serendipity of the swooning music, even after understanding that fitting in was what Dad wanted too, and the withered souls to be Poles, French, and German, to belong to the ever-westward expanding magnificence of some manifest destiny. No matter how impossible and the harm done to oneself and others, why every morning we sat at the kitchen table steeped in grief and irresistible hunger, hating our coffee, cereal, and broken minds, watching snow fall over every tired tree, house, and hour of our utter bewilderment, believing nothing worked out, waiting for an always late, beaten to a pulp truth to arrive, until one January morning, I suddenly started crying and never stopped. This is from The God of Loneliness, a selected in new poems that came out a year ago. And this is Failure, a poem we talked about. To pay for my father's funeral, I borrowed money from people he already owed money to. One called him a nobody. No, I said, he was a failure. You can't remember a nobody's name. That's why they're called nobodies. Failures are unforgettable. The rabbi who read a stock eulogy about a man who didn't belong to or believe in anything was both a failure and a nobody. He failed to imagine the son and wife of the dead man being shamed by each word, to understand that not believing in or belonging to anything demanded a kind of faith and buoyancy. An uncle counting on his fingers my father's business failures, a parking lot that raised geese, a motel that raffled honeymoons, a bowling alley with roving mariachis, failed to love and honor his brother, who showed him how to whistle under covers, steal apples with his right or left hand. Indeed, my father was comical. His watches pinched. He tripped on his pant cuffs and snored loudly in movies where his weariness overcame him, finally. He didn't believe in savings, insurance, newspapers, vegetables, good or evil, human frailty, history, or God. Our family avoided us, fearing boils. I left town, but failed to get away. The God of Loneliness. It's a cold Sunday, February morning, and I'm one of eight men waiting for the doors of Toys R Us to open in a mall on the eastern tip of Long Island. We've come for the Japanese electronic game that's so hard to find. Last week, I waited 3 hours for a store in Manhattan to disappoint me. The first today, bundled in six layers, I stood shivering in the dawn light, reading the new Aeneid translation, which I hid when the others came, stamping boots and rubbing gloveless hands, joking about sacrificing sleep for ungrateful sons. My boy broke two front teeth playing hockey, a man wearing shorts laughs. This is his reward. My sons will leap into my arms, remembering this morning all their lives. The game is for my oldest boy, just back from Iraq, a man in overalls says from the back of the line. He plays these games in his room all day. I'm not worried. He'll stamp out of it. He's earned his rest. These men fix leaks, lay foundations for other men's dreams without complaint. They've been waiting in the cold since Aeneas founded Rome on rivers of blood. Virgil understood that death begins and never ends, that it's the god of loneliness. Through the window, a clerk shouts, "We have only five." The others seem not to know what to do with their hands, tuck them under their arms or let them hang naked and useless. Is it because our hands remember what they held, the promises they made? I know exactly when my boys will be old enough for war. Soon three of us will wait across the street at Target, because it's what men do for their sons. At the Manhattan Social Security Office. It begins with a quote from Miguel de Unamuno. The mind seeks what is dead, for what is living escapes it. I'm practicing the stoic art of insouciance, not because I prefer not thinking about what signing up for Medicare means, or why so many who came after me are being called first, but because downstairs my soul was examined for signs of violence and duplicity. Its fatigue and ambivalence were invisible, apparently. In the next row, a man is telling a girl bobbing to an iPhone to sit still before the guard returns. When I was her age, signing up meant going to Vietnam, which meant practicing the Zen art of vanishing. At the windows, a blind man is asking why he didn't receive his disability payments in prison. He needs his sustenance. Behind me, another man is asking to see my paper. He's looking for work, he says. Happy to be free of Afghanistan, what could be done, I hand him my New York Review of Books. Bismarck said explaining was a weakness. As her father explains the necessity of securing her future, the girl squirms. She fears only boredom. I feared everything. In 5 months, my father would die, and mother and I would live on the $200 a month his Social Security paid. At the windows, the blind man is practicing the existential art of groveling, exposing the stitches on his scalp to a clerk who's practicing the cynical art of indifference. The girl's soul, hovering near the ceiling, is enjoying its moment of radiance. My soul, fretfully pacing the water cooler, is practicing the fatalistic art of understanding that nothing can be done about Afghanistan, that in order to influence the future, we must kill it.